Okay, now I start, and in my following talk, I will analyze the phenomenon of understanding. And perhaps today it's the day where we try to differentiate phenomenology from different other epistemologies, like embodied cognition or praxis theorie. And now my attempt is here to differentiate phenomenology and hermeneutics. So I will try to answer two questions. How do we understand each other? And second, can a pedagogical understanding be regarded as a special practice of understanding and be defined as such? Two questions. And first, I will, okay, it's just, you don't have to read it. It's a lot, so you see, I have to hurry up a little bit. So it's always too much. So first, I try to come to Deltay, Husserl, Gadamer, and Heidegger. So these are some hermeneutic series and phenomenological series concerning the subject of understanding. And then I will come to another approach. You will see it here, understanding the other. And I will try to explain understanding from the perspective of foreignness and otherness as a practice, an intersubject practice, an embodied practice, and last but not least, as a pedagogical practice. So, first, I will come to the subject's understanding. In early texts by Schleiermacher, Deltay, and Husserl, understanding is conceptualized as starting from the subject. The subject's understanding as subject genitive and objective genitive makes a duality. The subject's understanding something or someone other than himself. This is a subjective genitive. By conceptualizing understanding under his own or her own constitutive conditions, understanding of the other, objective genitive, is thus determined from the perspective of self-understanding. I quote, "We call the process in which we decipher a meaning out of central exterior signs understanding." Deltay gives an example for this process, the face of a child. The exterior of this face articulates itself in the form of facial expressions. His interior, however, has a certain meaning, a sense, comprehensive grief, pain, disgust, or like. Understanding is therefore defined as a process of decoding, which moves from the exterior to the interior. I understand the meaning of the facial expression by understanding a deeper sense behind the surface of expression. This understanding depends on a preconception which, as a referential historical context, makes up a general from which the particular, the face, can be deduced and understood meaningfully. Meaning, therefore, presupposes a sign, and the sign itself presupposes that it is already understood as such. The process of understanding, thus, can be seen as a circular motion. Schleiermacher already defines the hermeneutic circle in a way that presupposes a schematic conception of the overall sense of the phenomenon before the actual process of understanding begins, in order to be able to understand or see something as something. According to Deltay, signs are read as expressions of an underlying meaning. Thus, an objectivated expression in the form of a text or an expression has to be presupposed. Understanding is thus orientated by the model of understanding as text. The understanding of the other as understanding the foreign, in German Fremdverstehen, is conceptualized starting with the intentions and actions of the subject. Understanding is defined as a semiotic, text-based, and subject-based inference. With this model of semiotic understanding, Diltai paved the way from methodizing the process of understanding, marking hermeneutics as a text-based science. Along with this analysis of intention, his analysis of intentionality and attentionality, Husserl also developed a theory of understanding as empathic understanding. The key concept of in this theory is the act of appresentation. If I see the face of the child from our example, I cannot see the back of the head. By appresenting the back of the head, by apprehending it along from the front side, the whole head is given to me in perception. I perceive the other, the child, in the same way as I perceive things. With these thoughts, Husserl can show that a simple conclusion by analogy, that is from outer appearance on inner processes, is not sufficient. He thus disagrees with Schleiermacher and Diltai on this point. He argues that one has to work out the intentional mode of experience of something else or someone else along with its corresponding mode of fulfillment. It is only then that we can understand other modes of perception in comparison to our own. The other, the child, is represented in an intentional act as embodied other. We can never completely transfer the other in our own sphere. There will always be, always remain a difference. We can apprehend the other, but his whole perception and his intentions and emotions cannot be understood. So Husserl only speaks of, I quote, a kind of apprehension, and I quote, a sort of making something apprehensible along with something else. The constitution of the other in representation and intention of the subject is taking place in the mode of passive synthesis. We heard it this morning. Given this, understanding is based on a relation of similarity and thus on empathizing with the other. Einfühlungstheorie. Within the limitation of our own self, Husserl is tackling the problem of the difference between understanding the self and understanding the other without giving up a transcendental philosophical and subject-centered perspective. Perception and understanding is orientated on the perception of things and objects. While Husserl gives relevance to the lived body in the process of understanding, Gadamer remains in the hermeneutic tradition. Gadamer claims that the practice of understanding is determined by tradition. He calls it context of tradition, Überlieferungszusammenhang, and Wirkungsgeschichte, history of effect. In this way, Gadamer criticizes both Diltai's model of semiotic understanding and the theory of empathic understanding. Understanding cannot mean to understand the author of a text better than he understood himself, as Schleiermacher and Diltai would claim. To quote Gadamer, understanding is not, in fact, understanding better, either in the sense of superior knowledge of the subject because of clearer ideas or in the sense of fundamental superiority of conscious over unconscious production. It is enough to say that we understand in a different way. In German, anders, dass man anders versteht, wenn man versteht. Understanding the other bears the danger of appropriating the other person in one's own understanding and thereby failing to recognize his or her own otherness. Understanding the other thus plays between the own and the foreign. Gadamer finally mediates this difference within the concept of fusion of horizon, Horizontverschmelzung. With this fusion, the matter which is understood is merged with the understanding subject. This merging becomes possible because both the understanding subject and the matter of understanding are taking part in the same history of effect. The historicity of understanding and the authority of the tradition vouch for understanding the other. However, in this theory, the otherness and foreignness of the other is egalized by the harmonistic model of fusion of horizons. The hermeneutic unity of interpreting and understanding finally guarantees a kind of self-understanding which is orientated on the model of text and language. Now I come to Heidegger, and I leave the subject-centered models. Heidegger withdraws from both Husserl's subject-centered perspective and traditional text-based hermeneutics. Based on a critique of Husserl's concept of intentionality and his idea that phenomenology is based on a transcendental consciousness, he develops a hermeneutic phenomenology of Dasein. Our perception, he says, is obstructed or shadowed by theoretical, scientific, and language-based conceptions. I quote, factually, our most humble perceptions and conditions are signified ones even more. They are already interpreted in a certain way. We do not primarily or originally see things and objects, but we first speak of them. More precisely, we do not express what we see. It is the other way around. We see what one says about the things. To come to a representation of a phenomenon within perception, that is the simple grasping of what we find, he says. We do not need to use reduction, like Husserl, but a hermeneutics of Dasein. The hermeneutics needs to examine life world or existential practices, like the Zeuganalyse, dealing with equipment, as well as existential structures such as angst, anxiety, being with others, or Gelassenheit. The basic ontological difference, that is the difference between the concrete beings and the fundamental beings, imply that understanding does not follow the subject-object model anymore. Within being with others, an ontological sense of understanding as being already understood or verständigt sein in German. That's a nominalization of a passive construction, which perhaps can be translated with being in the world in the mode of understanding. In German, we can make all these things with our language, nominalizations of verbs, and putting them in a passive sense. So we can explain something which is perhaps in English might more complicated. Yeah? Before, he says, before we understand, we are already understood. And we understand before we understand in an explicit semiotic or analogy-based way, we are placed already in certain relations of Dasein, which are constitutive for the understanding of ourselves, world, and others. Understanding, with Heidegger, becomes a fundamental ontological relation under the condition of deconstruction of Western metaphysics. He criticizes the metaphysic presumptions of previous philosophical and hermeneutic approaches to understanding. In Heidegger's philosophy, the other is a radical other of the being, which cannot be grasped or experienced in ontic, grammatical, or theoretical categories. This event of understanding, he says, Ereignis, can only be approached in a literary or poetic way, for instance, in the work of Hölderlin or Trakl. With the critique of subjectivity, understanding the other is seen as a passive experience within the horizon of an event related to being. So I can see three problems of a subject-centered understanding. First, understanding in hermeneutic tradition as semiotic and empathic understanding cannot account for radical otherness. There I quote Levinas and Wilfried Lipitz. It can only grasp the otherness and foreignness of the other in a trivialization, equalizing, and even colonizing way. Second, the primacy of language and the spoken word within text brings also along a presentism of the sign. This implies the need to conclude from the surface to a so-called Hinterwelt, a world behind the sign, by interpreting the sign. Understanding becomes an explication of a concealed latent meaning. The presence of what which is visible is devalued in favor of the latency of the non-visible. The question now is, how can something latent, enigmatic, and implicit can be brought to the surface? How can something which might be not be expressible in words, by which shows itself, can be expressed anyway? How can we, to quote Nietzsche, get rid of the belief in grammar as a semiotic god, he said. Third, the general flame, das Allgemeine, in understanding is, according to Schleiermacher, Dilthey and Gadamer, the context of tradition, the history of effect. The context generates the greater common of understanding as a precondition for the possibility of intersubject understanding. The question at hand is, what happens if this greater common, das Allgemeine, be it society, the nation state, religion, or community, is fractured in many small parts and is replaced by difference, heterogeneity, and singularity? What if there was no general binding whole, no final synthesis, but only decentered and heterogeneous units? What does it mean for the practice of understanding? I come to the understanding of the other. I would like to draw to a philosophy of otherness, to explore the phenomenon of in-between in more detail, the in-between of intersubjective, intergenerative, interaction. This philosophy is based on an inversion. It is not the subject who constitutes understanding, but the other. The call of the other forces me to respond to it. However, it would be inadequate to only think of this call as a verbal utterance, even gesture, a certain look, the face, a gaze can provoke me to enter into a certain relation with the other, which Levinas calls Verantwortung, Waldenfels calls responsive event, and Nancy calls exposition. And this French word is the French word peau, skin drin, exposition. The call of the other is not something we react to. Even ignoring a call or overlooking a gesture would be a reaction to the call. The response is an event, not a state or an intentional action. In fact, the embodied response to a call shows the passivity of every experience. With the response, an embodied space of resonance opens up. Thus, the responsive event as embodied act has to be seen in the difference of ownness and otherness, like Waldenfels points out. The call of the other can be described as which cannot be expressed in words. This also implies that there is a sphere prior to the linguistic which becomes visible in the embodied expressions, in gestures, mimics, in the gaze. Understanding is thus an affective and embodied response which encompasses emotions, moods, atmospheres, as well as the materiality and symbolic spheres of pedagogical regimes and arrangements. Husserl differentiates in the Logische Untersuchung the sign as an expression, Ausdruck, from the sign as an indication, Anzeichen. I will now describe the difference between embodied expression and semiotic indication, or between showing and saying, which is at the foundation of a theory of understanding as responding to the call of the other. In the second step, I will sketch to a theory of intercorporeal understanding in pedagogy. Husserl underlines the pre-predicative and pre-objective dimension of embodied experience. The lived body is the zero point of all orientation, which enables temporal, spatial, social, and worldly orientation. At the same time, the lived body withdraws from all rational disposition, entzieht sich, Entzug. As we can see when we look at experiences like falling asleep, waking up, shame, disgust, pain, laughing, crying or dreaming. All these embodied mute experiences, like Husserl said, mute, also die stumme Erfahrung, can only be expressed in language in an ex post way. Within the linguistic expression, we articulate something which is elusive and withdraws from our grasp at the level of relation. Merleau-Ponty shows that the ex post articulation of experience is not a simple representation or translation of the mute experiences. It's a signification, he says. In fact, the embodied expression has to be differentiated from the symbolic expression, and the lived body has to be differentiated from language. This double sense of the sign, like Husserl says, between expression and indication comes then into play. With these assumptions, understanding cannot be seen in the mode of symbolic representation and decoding of signs, but as a response to a call. Understanding is not concluding inner states from outer appearance, like Diltai says, but an embodied responsive practice. The difference between understanding the self, understanding and understanding the other, or the difference between impression and expression is not mediated but kept alive as a fruitful difference. It is through embodied expressions that we can approach the other, the intentions and emotions of the other. His or her experiences become obtainable in call and response. Understanding as a non-objectifying response can come to linguistic expressivity in an ex-post mode. We thus deal with the circular structure of antecedent parts, the expression, the gesture, and subsequent parts, the response, which cannot be skipped or overcome. I will now try to flesh out the difference between linguistic, semiotic, and non-linguistic embodied understanding in order to answer my first question. On the one hand, embodied expressions require a cultural system of symbols and language in which we are situated, as embodiments have a cultural and social dimension. The body and its materiality are thus part of the processes of normalization which go along with the social order and regimes. In their ability to be repeated and reproduced, I quote now Derrida, embodiments are also based on conventions and norms which are cited and varied in repetition. Mimics and gestures are based on a material ability to be repeated, which leads to conventions that reproduce cultural and social norms. It is this conventionality and normalization which makes the gestures and embodiments understandable. The cultural and social horizon in this perspective is the condition for the process of conventionalization and normalization embodied expressions. We call this, in Judith Butler's terms, an embodied subjectivation. On the other hand, embodiments are based on the differences in following the rules, in the very moment in which they are performed. A repetition as a copy true to the original is, in fact, impossible. There's always a kind of interruption, discrepancy, and variation, something singular which is not repeated because it cannot be repeated. Within repetition, there's a moment of withdrawal from symbolic and discursive decoding and representation. This singular event marks a surplus of the lived body which cannot be signified. In this performativity of repetition, which makes repetition become an event. But in this moment of showing himself or herself in response to the call of the other, the one showing himself or herself and the one responding to it both show themselves, they expose them. Embodiment thus is based on an existential exposition, like Nancy says. The symbolism of the cultural order, which is basically decodable in a semiotic way, is being undermined by the non-representable specific sense of the lived body. Within the performativity of embodiment, a surplus emerges, which can imply something existential within exposition. Expression and response withdraw themselves from the social norms and as a consequence from symbolic understanding as they occur as performative events and experiences. Now I come to my last point, pedagogical understanding, and I would like to explain it because this is very short, but it is for me in our German pedagogy, we try to face the pedagogical themes or the pedagogical perspective not as an addition to our philosophical thinkings. It is the other way around. We call it Gegenstandstheorie. It's a theory of the subject of our science as educational science. So we think about the Gegenstand, the subject of our science. And now I want to ask in this grundlagentheoretischer Perspektive, perspective of the foundations of our science, as the foundation of understanding and responding to another. We are publishing an anthology of the early works of phenomenology and education in Germany, and the first text of Alois Fischer of 1914, he focuses this perspective, the subject, the Gegenstand of educational science must be regarded. So it is not like some of my colleagues says, a Jesus jump. Well, first we have pedagogy and then we jump. First we have philosophy or cognitive science and then we jump into pedagogy. No, it's the other way around. We have to focus this in a reflexive and systematic way. Okay. Along this borderline between the speakable and unspeakable, or between subjectivation and individualization, the event becomes manifest as showing itself, as an existential expression and individual sense. The duplicity of embodiment between materiality and performativity enables a description of embodied responses. The duplicity rejects the logic of grammar by making the specific sense of the lived body comprehensible. Embodiments are visible and can be described. They can be felt and experienced. Social situations become readable as an expressive, responsive event which takes place in front of the others, as well as in the process of signification. Within this process of intercorporeal understanding, subjective expressions can be described in their non-linguistic dimensions. It may sound paradox, but here lies the impossible possibility of signifying something that is at the same time prior to language and for which any linguistic description always comes too late. Concerning my first question, how do we understand each other? I have been trying to sketch a perspective on understanding as intercorporeal event, which takes place in the mode of embodied responses to embodied its expressions. Now I will come to my second question. Such as hermeneutic of expression, which I try to develop now, opens a new perspective for a theoretically informed research in Bildung and education for pedagogical empiry, I say. This also offers a shift from the perspective from dialogue and discourse to the implicit and embodied dimensions. Given this background, I have suggested a theory of pedagogical interattentionality. Shared attentionality is based on two different practices, the practice of becoming attentive as a singular experience, and the practice of showing, which aims attentiveness in the pedagogical context. But it is always meant that showing not only means an intentional showing, it's even showing himself by showing something. It's in the same time non-intentional. This basic assumption to draw this conclusion was that showing aims at attentionality and attentiveness. Attentiveness is, like Hegel says, the beginning of Bildung. This renders attentiveness as an important category for the theory of Bildung. Phenomenological analysis can show that we can only be attentive to something which shows itself, which really concerns and affects us. Following Heidegger, we can say that the first there has to be something which shows itself, the phenomenon, and then we can show it. It is only afterwards that we can show something to someone, as this someone shows itself as something specific. In pedagogical contexts, there is mostly someone who shows something as something specific in front of others. This is accompanied by the fact that the person showing something also shows himself or herself, and that the other show themselves in front of groups of others. Given this complex situation, showing can be seen as a singular experience of showing oneself on the one hand and as pedagogical interaction on the other hand. In this interplay, gesture-based showing is mostly prior to the spoken word. So you can see here, there's a pedagogical interaction and this guy is showing something in the classroom. It is a chemical thing. He shows. Bitte? Also, this guy shows something by showing himself in front of others who shows in themselves in the same moment. So, we often have regarded this in our video studies, and we see that this showing is prior to the spoken words. First they show something, show themselves, they react in the way of gestures and mimics, and then they say something, not the other way around. So, in this situation, we have two perspectives, the teacher on the left and the pupil on the right, and the guy with the long hair who is merging with the hands. There is a process we can described as an inter-attentional, interactive relation, because they try to understand each other, but in this moment they misunderstand. But in this misunderstanding, they are really attentive to each other, and they try to explain what they say with hands and with the mimics. So it's a situation of an inter-attentionality, I would say. Processes of learning and education can thus be described as embodied practices in an intercorporeal responsive event. The sociality of education as shared experiences in learning and teaching. In these situations, participants respond on the expression and the call of the other, or they don't. This can happen in different ways, in conversation, in mimics, gestures, by showing something or showing oneself, or even by concealing something. Such a perspective could prove fruitful for a theory of pedagogical understanding, which includes the dimensions of the lived body and embodiment. It could be applied to the fields of inclusive education, early childhood education, cultural education, and other fields where tacit dimensions and aspects of the lived body become relevant in learning and teaching. Thank you very much for your embodied understanding.